that are appointed to assist in the running administration of justice in every court. Based on the structures that I have enumerated, there would be very, very little problems, except for the fact that whatever a chief judge does, a judge of any high court will not see, in most cases, will not see good in him. So long as he is not ready to allow them to dictate to him as to how he will run his office when he wants to confine himself with the rules, regulations that have been set up by the financial instructions. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thank you, the Secretary. Well, let chief registrars are the cause of their own problems. One, they use the divide and rule between the head of court and the judges or justices. I do expose grimly. When my sister here was the chief registrar of the Court of Appeal, she used all she knew how to use, I mean, in terms of administrative acumen, to make sure, and that is what Baba was referring to. There was a case that from their mobilization money from Lagos to Abuja, she saved a very big sum of money. And with the permission of the head of court, bought cars for her justices. Some people wrote petition, and she was invited to SSS to come and explain all this. She owned up that she did it based on the instruction, and the head of court owned up that, yes, I directed her to do it. If you want to arrest her, arrest me. Some of these new chief registrars would do things without telling their heads of court. Some of them only know that if they are able to satisfy their heads of court, they don't have any problem. Forgetting that if all judges rebel against the head of court, the seat will not be an easy seat for him or her to sit. But I believe the easiest way is to do things the way they should be done. During our own days, our God will tell you, don't do this. But who are you to confront the justice of the Supreme Court and say, the Chief Justice said, we should not do this? You maneuver your way. You do it. There was an occasion the Chief Justice called me. He said, what did I tell you about Sozo? I said, my Lord, you said Sozo. Say, what did you do? I said, my Lord, about what? I said, you did, so I said, my Lord, I did, sir. Tell me why I will not discipline you. I said, my Lord, I'm very sorry if I have offended you. Our duty here is to ensure that there is cordiality between your lordship and your brother justices. And that is what I have done. But if I have offended your lordship, I'm very sorry, I never meant. It's okay. You can go. This is the way. Because when two elephants fight, it is the grass that suffers. Then about 200,000 where I disagree with my colleague. At the state level, NJC was so kind to be given 200,000 so that their day-to-day needs will be met. What you decide that some of these chief judges pocket this money, they don't give a dime out to the judges. I won't mention states. Up till now, they don't give them. And that is why they have been fighting. They will collude with the chief registrar. They will be spending this money. Now, I told one of them, if you say it's not for sharing, what are the judges benefiting? He said, the money is in the bank. I said, how much is the interest that is being gained from this? Is it not a misappropriation of the budget? Are you now saying that the amount budgeted is now co-allocated by the interest you have not given? So what they now do is that they now say, okay, you judge, we'll give you 100,000 out of the 200,000, we'll give you 50,000. Then you must return, you know, retire it with receipts that we will send to the NG. Then definitely, this money has been given to them, and the chief registrar is on their neck that they must retire. They will go and get a constitutionally debt for computer this, computer that, so that they can retire the monies given to them. But at the federal level, we do have that problem. That is why maybe the executive is not aware. This will continue to cause problems between the judges and the heads of God and the state, and the registrar, the chief registrar, who is not diplomatic, will continue to have the problems on his or her head. But one thing I think you can do is that not that the chief registrars are not able to satisfy the judges. You behave as a responsible and very humble human being. You are not losing anything. If you pick your phone and phone madam, madam, hope there is no problem in the house. What can I do if there is any problem? Oh, my cooker is, madam, I will be there. I will send an officer to be there just a minute. Then, this is what we are doing during our, every week we divide chambers into numbers. You must visit the chambers of your justice, my lord, just to say, if everything is, oh, no, thank you, this year, everything is, okay, tomorrow now, if all of us sitting here who have worked in the very jury want to enter the court of appeal of the Supreme Court, I will get whatever I want. She will get, mother will get, Isha will get, because we served them with all our, and even when they were going, they were passing on to the new justices that, oh, this was my list, it was my thing. Please, you use your diplomacy to achieve what you said, the goal he said in his paper. It's difficult to work as a chief registrar. Your junior staff, they are against you. Then you told me you can't satisfy us. But you are in between two levels. But, I mean, here and there, you use, but the truth is that the chief registrars, most of them are selfish. Very selfish. Because they don't want to balance that equation between fraud, the judges, and the junior staff. Some of them, they don't even delegate authorities at all. Some of them, they have decided this person can never go beyond this level, so why cannot be created. So this should not be. Please go, if you cannot talk here, the purpose is for you to go outside your mind. God, this work you are doing, God sees your mind, sees my mind. What do you think is your problem? You cannot say it here. Because by the time they'll be dealing with you at the GNC, it will be too late. You won't be there when your head of court will be reporting you. And that's why they want to know what are your problems, so that if these complaints eventually get to them, they will now know, oh, this is what likely to have happened before. For instance, we are requiring to go to a CR was removed of recent because of the complaint from the head of court. We don't want that to happen. It's a bad thing for the judiciary. It's sad that someone who has worked with the position of a chief, then that he is asked to retire compulsorily. What now he, what is he going to do? He can't become a judge. Is he going to start legal practice? These things, we don't want it to happen to you people. And for that, please say one thing or the other, or you keep quiet, and when your face has to be determined, either as a judge, either as a disciplinary matter. I was outspoken when I came this morning. I never had a problem with my new CR, because she does everything Justice Aya wants, just said. She comes to me in the morning to brief me when I'm going, oh, God, this is the approval I want. This has to be written there. Because I have the confidence. Yeah, put that confidence in your head of what, and the judges as well. Thank you.
This seminar, this workshop is going on. I said, okay, let me come in and say hello to a few friends. I just want to say that the position of the chief registrar is a very, very delicate one. But I believe that as matured administrators, if they are really, first of all, if they are really honest, and if they are people of high integrity, that's the first thing. Things will be well.
Sorry, you don't know who is speaking. This is His Royal Highness of Ajakaidi, the lady of the. Before then, he was a commissioner in the old Western state, he was a high court judge in the old Ondo state, he was the first chief judge of the Kiki state, he was the administrator of this institute.
As the former chief judge of the state, within 7 years I was a chief judge, at least 4 chief registrars passed through me to become judges. And my experience with them is that if a chief registrar is honest and hardworking, Surely the sky is its limit. But first of all, there is this problem of chief registrars with judges. One of the states in the southwest, 22 of the judges wrote a petition and signed it against their chief judge. And their complaint was mainly because of the attitude of the chief registrar. Unfortunately, the chief registrar was removed. At the end of it, the chief judge was removed, which is a very sad situation. To me, the chief judge should be open and also allow the chief registrar to actually interact with all the judges. I think it can be said that the chief registrar is not the chief register of the chief judge, it's a chief register of court. And therefore, whatever is right for the chief register to do for the chief judge, he or she must be allowed also to interact with the other judges and to take care of them. The executive secretary of NDC was trying to explain another problem. Where judges are given 200,000 per month for maintenance. Some judges will say, well, this is my money. I want the whole 200 naira. And we want the chief registrar to release the 200,000 naira to them. Again, when there is a conference in Abuja, you know, organized by NGI, they will want the chief judge again to make available to them some money to come to Abuja. Already, the 200,000 will have been released to him. Now the problem is, how does the chief judge get money again to sponsor you for another seminar when you are taking the 200,000? So some chief judges decided, let's divide this money into two. You take 100,000. You keep 100,000 in the pool. But up to now, there is still a lot of problem on this issue. In some states, they say they allow 150,000. Some states say 100,000. Some will say, take your 200,000 and with all your trouble. This is why they now have to go and look for receipts to cover up the 200,000. So I think it is a system. Quite honestly, in the past, any money coming in like that would have to be spent by the chief registrar. But this is not the case now. There are no official quarters any longer. Judges decide to live on their own and take the money for accommodation. So I think what the chief minister this is my own view, in how the judges spend the money meant for them. If they run into trouble, well, they should be able to explain to NDC. Because if you spend the money for them and they are not satisfied, they continue to write petitions and petitions for a complaint about the chief register. I thank you very much.
So my Lord Justice Ishak Bello is representing the chief judge of the FCT and is presenting a paper, but he has another assignment in the office to do now for another event tomorrow, so he has sought the permission to allow him to present the paper on behalf of the CJFCT. So Justice Bello is a judge of the FCT. He became a judge about more than 12 years ago. Before then, he was a magistrate in Kaduna State. He was a deputy chief registrar in the staff of the court. He's the number three in the hierarchy of the judges of the FCT. I call him Mugu, because when we're together, he's Mugu.
Well, the chairman of this service commission, my lord, Honorable Justice Zanyahu, JCA, my brother judges on the party who are the secretary of the Federal Judicial Service Commission, secretary of the NJC, distinguished participants. First, I would like to thank my lord, Honorable Justice of KK, for deferring to me, because I have some engagement against tomorrow's event that's likely to take place in the morning. I'm coordinating, and so I have to rush back to ensure that things are taking proper care. Now, the topic of my paper, as probably you must have seen, deals with rules of court, High Court of Justice, Federal Capital Territory, Abuja. At first, when I saw the letter asking me to write on this topic, and my target audience would be the chief registrars, deputy directors, and other quasi-judicial offices, my blood pressure rose almost out of proportion, because knowing the sophistry and degree of receptive minds that I'm likely to meet in the target audience is likely to be highly intimidating, and probably they may find me very, very much inadequate. So I prayed hard that may God help me and guide me through, so that I will not, in jitters, state of jitters, make the blunders of one of my colleagues in secondary school in the class of literature. Then there was the practice every week. Each of the students will be given a chapter to go and read, and then he will come and stand before the class to tell what his understandings of the chapter was. So this man, our classmate, was given a chapter as it was his turn. So for the first time, he was standing facing the crowd. In confusion, he wanted to say that most of the words were above his capacity. He looked right, top, left and the center, and looked at the teacher and said, "Sir, most of the words are above my dignity." It was an Indian tutor. He said, "Dignity or capacity?" And since then, we have been nicknaming him Dignity or Capacity up to today. I think my prayers have been answered. Though I may be jittery inwardly, it is not visible enough for you to see it. So I hope you will pardon me if you, at the end of the day, find it inadequate. Now, the theme of the workshop is capacity building for improved service delivery in the federal judiciary. Now, before I go in, whose capacity? Whose capacity is the theme addressing? Certainly, it is your capacity. It is your capacity. It is your capacity. Everybody's capacity here and the participants. And I want to say that once your capacity is at stake, it is expected that you will be glued to your seat, with rough attention, with that open-mindedness to receive the receivables with a view to improving that capacity, which will ultimately improve service delivery in the federal judiciary. When the Honorable the Chief Justice of Nigeria was making his comments, he did allude to some lapses identified in your passes. And unless you, in your capacity as head of the administration, are well improved, you are certainly lacking in that capacity or ability to call those you are subordinates to tell them this is the right thing to do. So it is apt that you as heads are gathered here today for the purpose of improving that competence in you, for the purpose of enhancing productivity. Now, this in simple terms means a conscientious effort on the part of the Federal Judicial Service Commission towards improving or enhancing the competence of the participants, with which increased productivity and qualitative service delivery will be expected within their various schedule of responsibilities in the judiciary and other quasi-judicial organizations. The target is to make the task of adjudicating a very important milestone in the history of the judiciary. It is a beautiful compliment to the continuous education program for both the judicial officers and support staff of the judiciary through the National Judicial Council, NJI, under the able leadership of the Honorable Chief Justice of Nigeria, CJN, GCOIN. I do not intend to go into definitions of what constitutes the respective header of the participants as stated. And I'm happy, my Lord, Honorable Justice Onyengi in his paper, and that of Honorable Justice Anyang JCE did eloquently present who these participants are through very elaborate definitions. I therefore do not take the liberty to adopt their definitions of mine. I take it for granted that no difficulties will be encountered in appreciating same. In any event, the discussion that will ensue in this paper will certainly make easy for comprehension of who really the participants are. Now, in order to sensitize you on the enormous responsibilities of the judiciary and therefore yours, I decided to start by alluding to constitutional provision, so that you will see the enormous responsibility that rests on the judiciary, and you will also come to agree that your own schedule, your own role as support staff, no matter the nomenclature, is interwoven, subsumed in the functioning of the judicial offices. I therefore find a convenient starting point in the preamble to the 1999 Constitution, as it relates to Section 6 of the said Constitution. It states thus, and I quote, "We the people of the Republic of Nigeria, having firmly and solemnly resolved to live in unity and harmony as one indivisible and indissoluble sovereign nation under God, dedicated to the promotion of inter-African solidarity, world peace, international cooperation and understanding, and to provide a constitution for the purpose of promoting the good government and welfare of all persons in our country on the principles of freedom, equality and justice, and for the purpose of consolidating the unity of our people, do hereby enact and give ourselves the following constitution." And under the constitution given to ourselves, and that is the 1999 constitution, the entire chapter 2 deals with the fundamental right. And these are as follows. I will allow you to read that. You'll have to go through it. The essence here is, fundamentally, these serve as the bedrock for the protectable rights of citizens, and for which the state is expected to protect for the purpose of enhancing the welfare of citizens and good governance. Any infringement of such rights is bound to raise eyebrow from the state, and the infringing body is bound to be brought to book. By Section 6.1 of the 1999 Constitution, the judiciary is so infringed upon. This the judiciary does through expounding, application and enforcement of laws, rules and regulations as stated by the Supreme Court in the cases of Benue State versus the Federation 1992, the citation there. It is therefore imperative for you to understand the enormous responsibility on the judiciary being an integral part of the three components of state. The duty to contribute its quota towards ensuring good governance through the protections of rights of persons, which in turn will enhance the welfare of people, and no doubt uncompromising the expectation of the public, which sees the judiciary as the indispensable access to remedy. Now, you see, you must appreciate, it is very, very cardinal that you should appreciate this sensitive role, because it is only the judiciary in the House of Representatives of the Senate that what you have done is contrary to law. It is only the judiciary that has the powers to tell anybody beneath whom that, look, respective previous speakers did allude to the fact that your position is very, very powerful and very, very important. It is, in fact, indispensable to the dispensation of justice, and everybody must acknowledge this fact. That is why when your capacity is at stake and a person can afford to doze or to fall asleep, when papers are being presented, it means one is already presenting himself, identifying himself as a misfit and ready to be shown out on ground of declined productivity. So I believe that he should be attentive and understand, like any of the other two arms of government, fulfill its undertaking to the Nigerian citizens as known in the Constitution. This everybody must understand. Now, what is the role of the participants? The role of the chief registrars, deputy chief registrars, directors, deputy directors, and other quasi judicial support staff is subsumed in the function of the judicial officers as statutory provided for the judiciary at all levels. That is to say, from the lower to the highest court of the land, where the administration of same rests on the shoulders of the participants. How these administrative roles affect the judicial functions in the judiciary is now the focal point. On this, I start by examining the right to fair hearing as provided in the various sections of the Constitution Universal Declaration. One, at the commencement of proceedings. And then, secondly, during the hearing of matters. And then the third, the post-judgment issue. These are the crucial areas which must be addressed, which your function will be seen as indispensable tool towards administration of justice. Now, these areas on fair hearing. The case of Adeni versus Governing Council of Yaba College of Technology 1903 with dissertation is there on those sections which are itemized dealing on fair hearing. The foregoing illustrates the operational principle of fair hearing. Indeed, section 57 of 1999 Constitution specifically enjoins that in the determination of his civil rights and obligations or any criminal charge against him, everyone is entitled to a fair and public hearing within a reasonable time by an independent and impartial tribunal established by law. Honorable Justice Kareem White did say, referring to those principles, I did comment referring to those principles in these words, and I quote, they are seen as universal principles of ancient origin and common to mankind. They were recognized by the ancient Greeks and the Romans, are recognized as part of our indigenous and other culture and philosophy of justice. It is indeed, as asserted by court, a principle of divine justice, unquote. The case of Adeniyi Supra is relying upon that comment. Now, that is just to show one area, and when I come to discuss the rules within the compartments that I have said, you will clearly see where the issue of fair hearing is very, very fundamental, and any error or derailment in your function is likely to bring about that unhealthy situation with untold hardship on litigants, and a lot of sometimes irreparable damage is occasioned by laxities from any of the functionings of the participant. Now coming to the FCT High Court rules. The realization of the cornerstone of justice as seen in the preceding discussion is now to be discussed against the background of the rules of the High Court of Justice, Federal Capital Territory. In the exercise of the powers conferred on me by Section 259 of the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, 1991, I, Lawal Hassan Gumi, Chief Judge of the High Court of the Federal Capital Territory Abuja, made these rules. One, the civil procedure rules set out in the schedule shall be the rules of civil procedure to follow in the High Court of the Federal Capital Territory Abuja. Now, that signaled the arrival and operation of the FCT High Court civil procedure rules. I do recall with sense of delight that my brother Honorable Joseph and me, and I took over to logical conclusion the entire review. I think even the Honorable Joseph Anyao, before her elevation, she was part and parcel of the process of review. I'm only taking the credit because I took it to final conclusion, but the baton was handed over to me in succession, and I think it is moment for the public to understand that that is the reason why I'm saying this. Now, by order 4 of the rules, it provides thus: a writ of summons shall be issued by a registrar. Now, wherever the registrar appears here, it refers to the chief registrar, deputy chief registrar, etc. So I don't have to stand interpreting at every given moment. Keep it at the back of your minds. Or other officer of the court empowered to issue the summons on an application. An application shall be made in writing by the plaintiff's solicitor who completes form 1 as in the appendix. Where an applicant for a writ of summons is illiterate or has no solicitor, a registrar or other officer of court may dispense with a written application, but himself put himself instead and record full particulars of the oral application made, and on that record a writ of summons may be prepared, signed, and issued. Now, before I get to the content of a writ, I just want to say a writ of summons is only one of the processes as provided under the rules and by which actions could be commenced. I single it out because I want to demonstrate something which you will see later in the course of this presentation. Now, the content of the writ. The writ of summons shall contain 1. The name and place of abode of the plaintiff and of the defendants so far as they can be ascertained, and B. How many amongst you here at one time or another have taken the liberty to call any bailiff or any registrar under you, like say the process registrar, to demand to know whether compliance is ever made with this provision. It may be order 4 or 40 under the MCT, but it is the same wherever. If you are coming from whichever area, but it is all the same. Whether it is Federal High Court, whether it is MCT, it's the same substance. Can you tell me by show of hand? I want to examine how much you have been exerting yourselves in establishing the fact that the proper thing is being done. Can I get any show of hand? How many times? Be honest between you and your God. Can I see by show of hand, as the brother will say, there you are. Yes, this is where the latency is. This is where it comes. Lack of supervision. A mere defect in a writ of someone could lead to a series of appeals from the court of first instance to the highest court with untold expenditure on the part of the litigants. And sometimes the writ may be there, you may decline to even draw the attention of the court. This is really sad. It is time for you to understand that you have the power, and it is your duty to monitor closely what is being done. You must ensure that contents of writs are reflected before they are issued, signed and issued out. This is fundamental. The above shows that in discussing the role of the participants as subsumed in the functions of the judicial offices, three broad categorization could be made in relation to court processes, while the dispensation of justice could be attained. Now, process itself is defined as any means used by a court to acquire or exercise its jurisdiction over a person or over specific property. It is a means whereby court compels appearance of defendant before it, or a compliance with its demands. See the case of Ajiola versus Sojoke. The citation is there, and Onoye versus Chukuma with all the citation. The law is that once a process is properly filed in the registry of the court, the party that filed it has done all that is required of him. For instance, the writ of summons under order 4 of the rules as discussed above is one of the court processes. It is the duty of the court register to ensure that there is compliance with the requirement for issuance of a writ of summons. Because it is only when there is a competent writ before the court that the jurisdiction could be properly invoked. The right party must be stated thereof. The exact name as given by the plaintiff, that is name of the plaintiff and defendant, must be accurately stated there in the writ. It must be noted that any defective writ is liable to be set aside over any authority. Okay, that's a valid. After a proper file issuance for it or any originating process, the next service of city. This signifies the delivering to or leaving the process with the party to whom or to whom they ought to be delivered or left. And when they are so delivered, they are then said to have been served. The service must provide a reasonable notice to defendant of proceedings to afford him opportunity to appear and be heard. That is the object of service of court process of parties to for these proceedings. There are two main types of service of process, namely personal service or substituted service. This means that the issuance of process and effective service of same are two conditions upon which the exercise of jurisdiction of a court is predicated. In all cases, service should be personal, except where it cannot be conveniently effected. Substituted service would then suffice. Now, the cases of Jehola and Swage K. Supra, the keys of Ogumola, Dixon versus Okori, Cheno, General Limited versus Adisa, all the citations are there for you to read and see. The fact that a writ must be properly issued in the first place, and where it is properly issued, there is proper civil rule, there's bound to be katakata. So I don't pray that you have katakata in your office. Huh. So take care and that. To connect to persons to deliberately cause defects in a writ, knowing fully it will lead to striking out of the suit or cause some damage either to the claimant or the defendant is equally an automatic ticket for dismissal. Is it that I have 30 minutes more or I have exhausted 30 minutes? 30 minutes to go. Okay, that's all right. I will soon. So for the service of process, during at the commitments of proceeding. Now, during, I'm not going into narrative. I will simply tell you, during the hearing of the matter, you have duty to ensure that process that are served during the hearing of the matter are grown and are taken to the attention of the judge. This you must impress on the court clerks directly attached to the judges, because where the process is not drawn to the attention of the judge and the matter proceeds, maybe it is a motion for stay of proceedings, and that has not been drawn to the notice of the judge, he proceeds with the matter. Decision of the appellate courts are to the effect that the judge is presumed to have had the knowledge of the existence of such process. Because once the party has taken all that is humanly possible to register, file the process before the court, it is entirely left to the business of the court to draw the attention of the judge responsible or the justice responsible. So the decision of the appellate court are to that effect, that the judge is present. And you see, in such a situation, it must have occasion, or is likely, or certainly going to occasion some kind of discomfort in terms of finances and what have you, in fact, injustice on the part of the litigant. But you see, this is usually as a result of a lack of diligence on the part of some of the staff. Now, let me go to the issue of custody of exhibits. Under order, through where there is undertaken for instrumental payment and the judgment data is readily forthcoming. Order 39, verse 8. Now, I will leave the issue of writ of attachment. You do your reading there because of time. And then I have also brought in the example of Supreme Court, going by section 87 of the 1999 Constitution on the manner of enforcement of judgment. And immediately after that, I dealt with the issue of execution of foreign judgment, just as the Supreme Court had its own rules, so the FCT rules. Then the garnishing proceedings I have also discussed there. You will see it clearly. The case of Red Diamond Bank Limited 2002, a court of appeal decision, is there to guide you properly. Finally, I will go, the issue of enforcement against guarantor is also there. Then the provision and management of archives. Mr. Chairman, just 2 minutes. That is going to the second to the last page. I want to say this on archives. It's very important. I decided to start this issue at this point in order to make an indelible imprint in the minds of the participants. This is a justice to this field. They are relegated or looked down upon as misfit or second class. It is not so. When I was Deputy Chief Registrar at the Supreme Court in charge of personnel and general administration, and you know, it is, there is a saying in Hausa that you don't tell lies near home because people will understand the truth. My brother Adejumo is here. We served there the Supreme Court together. I made sure that it is the best brains, responsible, experienced, and dedicated staff, minus the S there, were posted to the archives. The reason being that the history of the Supreme Court and so any court can only be best judged from its history and the decisions contained in the storage there in the archive. It is not therefore a place to toy with, as that will amount to reducing to insignificance what is highly treasured. Conclusively, generally the participants should be concerned with the following, as graphically stated. One, that there is a duty of honesty on their part. Two, duty of diligence and commitment to duty. Three, being the first port of call by litigants, they must truly behave as good ambassadors of the judiciary, either at the beginning, middle, or end of proceedings. The need for access to court and justice should not be impeded by any negative behavior on their part. Substitution service by courier or other similar outfits. Proof of sale is evidence of receipt, not that it has been posted. A lot of people make the mistake and they receive documents showing that there has been posted. No, proof of service is evidence of receiving where such any outfit is employed for the purpose of service. Court officials must not participate in the purchase of attached property in the execution of judgment. This, I decided to put it at the end in order to make a lasting impression. A lot of you are very much in a rush to go to attachment and dispose by sale certain property attached in satisfaction of judgments and so on. You should know that it is perilous. Quickly, I recall, before the creation of Katsina State, a chief magistrate who had been a judge in Katsina, and probably even the CJ, had a carry forward a problem of buying exhibits from the former Kaduna State up to Katsina State. And ultimately that militated against his being a judge. In fact, he's even out of the judiciary for ages. So you should understand this. You should know this and guard against this, because it tends to block the well-cherished principle that justice is not only to be done, but must be said to have been done. Because whatever you do, it is seen vigorously as having done by the judges. It will even go to the conclusion that the decision was handed down because you are interested, or the judge is interested in the property, and you must avoid that. Money deposits must be used or handled in the
manner. My lord, please try and...
In conclusion, may I thank immensely the Federal Judicial Service Commission for accepting my nomination by my Honorable CJ, Honorable Judge Gumi of Gustavo, a resource person for this 2-day workshop. But this modest presentation, I cannot claim to have discussed exhaustively the FCT High Court rules of court. What I did was to address those areas that I consider pertinent for the effective functioning of the target audience as shown above. I do hope I have been able to impact meaningfully on the said audience, at least by way of provoking positive thinking and other discussion on the subject of this presentation. I thank you for listening.
Thank you, my Lord, Honorable Justice Ishaq Bello. And that was quite a good presentation. Now, let me just say that we will quickly take 2 more papers. I know most of you will be hungry, but let us just round off this afternoon session. You go for your lunch, then from there, you go away to come back tomorrow. The lunch is very sumptuous, and the temptation is that if we start eating the lunch now, it might take us about an hour to do so. And when we come back, there's diminishing returns. So we'll just exercise of patience. I'm sure you've come from all parts of the country for this program. So we will take two quick papers, and thereafter we will make general comments. The next presentation is going to be done by Honorable Justice Okechukwu Okeke of the Federal High Court, who will also give us an overview of the Federal High Court rules. I'm sure you are aware there are new rules, and that he will draw our attention to certain points. My Lord, you have just shown all protocols, and that goes with.
Section 7 of the Federal High Court Act also provides for the division of the court. Section 9 of the Federal High Court Act states thus: 1. The jurisdiction vested in the court shall, so far as practice and procedure are concerned, be exercised in the manner provided by this Act or any other enactment, or by such rules and orders of court as may be made pursuant to this Act. 2. Where a matter arises in respect of which no provision or no adequate provisions are made in the rules made under Subsection 1 of this Act, or in any other act or enactment, the court shall adopt such procedure as it deems to do substantial justice between the parties concerned. This provision of Section 9 sub 2 of the Federal High Court Act has been given judicial recognition by the Supreme Court in the case of Vulcan Cases Limited against GF Industries Limited, 2001, 9 Nigeria Law Court, but 719 at page 610. Section 254 of the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria empowers the Chief Judge of the Federal High Court to make rules for regulating the practice and procedure of the Federal High Court. In the exercise of the said powers, the Honorable Chief Judge made the following rules: A. Bankruptcy Rules of 1990, Companies Proceeding Rules, Companies Winding Up Rules 2001, Federal High Court Tax Appeal Rules 1992, Admiralty Jurisdiction Procedure Rules 1993, and Federal High Court Civil Procedure Rules 2009. The Federal High Court Civil Procedure Rules 2009 came into force on 30th April 1999, like its precursors, the 1976 and 2000 rules of the court, remain the main rules of the court. The preeminence of the Federal High Court Civil Procedure Rule 2009 over the other rules in the court is clear from the provisions of Order 3, Rule 1 thereof, which states, subject to the provisions of any enactment, civil proceedings may be begun by writ, originating summons, originating motion or petition, or by any other method required by other rules of court governing a particular subject matter. Rule 158, Bankruptcy Rules 1990, and Rule 183, Companies Winding Up Rules, provide that in any proceedings in or before the court, where no provision is made in the particular rules, the court civil procedure rules shall apply. The Federal High Court Tax Appeals Rules 1992 provides in Order 11 thus: 2. Service of subpoena. The Federal High Court Civil Procedure Rules shall also apply in respect of service of any subpoena on any person. 3. Subject service. Where service of a notice or other document on a party to an appeal in one of the manners specified in this order has proved impracticable, an application may be made ex parte to the court for subject service in accordance with the civil procedure rules of the court. Rules of court are of paramount importance in the administration of justice. They govern both the courts and the litigants. They are not merely cosmetic. They are meant to be obeyed. In the case of Boysen's PLC against Daniel Kallio, 2006, 5 Nigeria Ukula Report, part 973-330 at page 355, paragraph F. Nikki Toby Jesse, opening thus: courts of law, like umpires in a game, cannot go outside the rules of court and do things the way they like. The parties are equally bound by rules of court. See the cases of this suit against Ajiro Wura, 2001, 4 Nigeria Law, against our father 2001, 1 Nigeria Weekly Law Report, part 694, page 282. Though rules of court are meant to be obeyed, it must be emphasized that the rules that the courts are hesitant to follow them strictly, where doing so will result in injustice, as courts exist to do substantial justice. Under 51 Federal High Court Civil Procedure Rules 2009 provides laws, effect of non-compliance, where in beginning or purporting to begin any proceeding, or at any stage in the course of, or in connection with any proceeding, there has by reason of anything done or left undone, been failure to comply with the requirements of these rules, whether in respect of time, place, manner, form, content, or in any other respect, the failure may be treated as an irregularity, and if so treated, will not nullify the proceedings or any document, judgment, or other therein. It may be necessary to say this, though it's not in my case. Why preparing a new rule? It was taken to be determined issued when it was signed by a judge. But under the new rules, we now take it that the ordinary summons, like other rules, once it is signed by a registrar, put the name for the judge to sign. Unfortunately, there was no judge sitting. The registrar, not the judge, I mean, not the station, not the CR or DCR, but any of the one of the judges in the process, out of sheer exercise, in TPEX, the word the judge, and put it and sign. And the objection was taken on that issue. But the judge who had objection was the judge said, no, once a party has done all that he's expected to do, any other if there's any confusion, it's in the registry, it cannot be listed on the litigant. So they object, they appeal against that the judge, the court appeal said that the judge was wrong. On further appeal to the Supreme Court, the Supreme Court held that what the judge of the court did in that case was right. That was the case of Fanfa Oil Limited against Attorney General of the Federation, 2003, 18 Nigeria Weekly Law Report, Federal High Court Civil Procedure Rules 2009. Under these new rules, we are now introduced front loading. But that 303 provides for the filing of list of documentary exhibits and witnesses to be called at the trial, written statement on oath of witnesses by the plaintiff, while Order 13 Rule 2 provides for the defendants filing a list of documentary exhibits and witnesses to be called at the trial, written statement on oath of witnesses. Now, there is what we call class action. That is taken care of by Order 9 Rule 4. That relates mainly to trademarks, copyrights, patents and designs, when to make an application, and freedom to opt out. You see, why we decide to take class action? In case of infringement, somebody's trademark may be infringed, and the person who is infringed will now distribute it to other people. So if you continue to sue all people, you may find it difficult. Say that all people in that class who are doing that business, the action will be taken against them. Now, we also try to limit the number of times the limitation of amendment of the nominating process are pleaded at any time before judgment to not more than 3 times. That is taken care of in Order 17.1. And penalty for failure to amend after obtaining an order of court for that purpose. Forfeit, because the person may forfeit the right to amend or may be subject to payment of additional fee of 200 naira for each day of that default in compliance. That is Order 17.41. After the payment of the additional fee for the default, an application for regularization exhibiting evidence of payment or the penalty up to the day of the filing of the amendment must be shown before the court to consider the application. That is taken care of in Order 17.42. And also, in any case, the court exists to do justice between the parties. People may like to settle, so that some people try to delay the proceedings. Say that every day we are trying to settle, every day we are trying to settle. That's we are taking care of that in Order 19 Rule 15. No, not Order, Order 18 Rule 1. So by limiting a period of 30 days to the party to explore possibilities of settlement of the dispute, where they fail, then the court will now proceed with the trial. And we are now, there is a case where you come and file a case, you are not ready to go on. It's taken as an indolent prosecution, taken care of by Order 19, Rule 15. A judge may, on his own motion or upon application by a party, strike out any proceeding for lack of diligent prosecution. And with, there may be an action for you to perpetuate a statement, a testimony. You take care of that under Order 20, Rules 25 and 26. Then you may also non-suit. Where a case, the power of court to non-suit, where satisfactory evidence is not given, entitling the plaintiff or the defendant to judgment of the court. In such a situation, the court, before doing that, must give the parties and their counsel opportunity to make submission on the propriety otherwise of making such an order. We now adopt written addresses to save time. That is taken care of in Order 22, Rule 1. The court shall have power to order the filing of written address in all cases. The order of filing written addresses, Order 22, Rules 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, provides for the mode, that is the order who files and what happens when you file a reply address. Absence of parties is taken care of in Order 22, Rule 9. That is when addresses have been filed and when people are not there to adopt. Addresses are deemed to have been adopted where party absent if the court is satisfied that all the parties have notice of the date for the adoption of the addresses. 13. Where a judge has written, there is another, but we have a problem here. You see, we are, because of experience, there may be a situation where a judge has written a judgment. Aside his judgment, either by death he made, and he could not deliver it due to grant of ill health or death or for any other reason. Such decision may be read by another judge of the court as the chief judge may direct. That is in Order 23. There is a case like that. If you look at the case of Attorney General of the Federation against ANPP, 2003. 15 Nigeria Criminal Law Report, Part 844, Appeal 600. It was a case that I did personally here in Abuja. Before that, this rule had not come. That was what we discussed it. I did the case here. When I was to write the judgment, I was on transfer to Enugu. Considering the nature of the case, I said, okay, I wrote the judgment, put it in a sealed envelope, sent to my learned brother, Justice Ewebo. He read the judgment. Objection was taken that he was not the person who wrote the judgment. So he overruled them on court of appeal. The court of appeal said that the objection was baseless because before Justice Ebobo read, he brought out the appeal and said that it was sealed in open court. And so that he added nothing. And the court of appeal said that there was nothing in our rule stopping another judge reading the judgment written by his learned brother. That was why we now decided to have it here in the to avoid such arguments. Judgment by consent. That is Order 23, Rules 8 and 9. Where a defendant has or does not have a legal practitioner, how a judgment could be entered. If there is a, whether he has a lawyer, if there is going to be a consent judgment, the counsel will sign. He himself will also countersign. If he has no counsel, he will not just sign it. He must be physically present in open court to say that he has consented whatever the judgment, so that to reduce much arguments. Signing of orders, Order 24, Rule 1. Every order shall be signed by the judge who delivered the decision. Yes, I know my time is up. But where the judge dies, where the judge dies or retired, or for any other reason, he is unable to sign the drawn up order, the order shall be signed by the chief judge. Legal practitioners, personal liability for cause. That is where he continues to delay the case on duty. And that we now deal with Atompila order, because in Atompila order is where somebody comes in, gets an application to go and raise somebody's shop, and that because of there's infringement of copyright or any other thing. He said, it's not just enough for you to come on that normal affidavit motion expert. Your affidavit must be detailed to show that you have a very strong case, a strong prima facie case. And then you might suffer serious damages. written addresses to be attached to ethnic applications. And now another thing is compilation of appeal. Somebody gets a judgment against somebody, another person says he's gone on appeal, he is just writing his notice of appeal and goes to say, we are taking care of that in order 32(3). An applicant for stay of proceeding or execution of a judgment shall cause to be compiled the records of appeal within 90 days from the date of filing a notice of appeal. And where the record is not compiled, the respondent may apply to strike out the application or discharge the order if already granted. There may be a situation somebody court will refuse an application, the man comes back and files a new one. He said, no, once it has been refused, it has been refused. You have to go to appellate court to take care of your papers. It's not my duty to waste the time of this August Assembly, but I have to touch on the issue of service of court process. No service shall be effected before 6 a.m. or after 6 p.m. Service effected after 6 p.m. shall be deemed to have been effected the following day, provided that service effected after 6 p.m. on Saturday shall be deemed to have been effected the following Monday. Defective service. Service before 6 a.m. shall, for the purpose of this rule, be deemed to be defective service. Transmission of an order. Now, under Section 22, Sub 2 of the Federal High Court Act, where a matter is instructed in the Federal High Court, which the court consider it has no jurisdiction, if it is a matter, instead of striking it out, it will be transferred to the appropriate State High Court or High Court of Federal Capital Territory. In such a situation, the registrar will compile all necessary papers, that is, transmission of the order and copies of all entries to the appropriate State High Court of High Court of Federal Capital Territory. We have decided to waive fees, payment of fees by government.